Ever get that feeling like someone's watching you online?
It's not paranoia.
Like, it's not if you'll get hacked, but when.
Yeah, that's the reality for a lot of people, especially at home.
And that's what we're diving deep into today.
Why home users are such big targets for cybercriminals.
We've got a ton of research here.
Oh yeah, some of it's pretty scary stuff.
But don't worry, we're not just here to scare you. We're bringing in the expert to break it all down.
Happy to be here.
Help us understand these complex issues.
And give you the tools to fight back.
Yeah, we want to make this practical.
Actionable advice you can actually use.
So let's jump right in.
Let's do it.
One thing that really struck me in the research is how much cyber criminals have shifted their focus.
Oh, absolutely.
They're realizing that individuals at home,
everyday people like you and me,
are a goldmine of data.
Credit card info, passwords, social security numbers.
And our security habits?
Well, let's just say there's room for improvement.
So we're sitting ducks.
Not ducks, exactly.
Yeah.
More like unsuspecting targets.
Okay, that makes me feel a little better.
Businesses have really stepped up their security game.
So they're going after the easier targets.
Exactly. Home users often rely on that basic advice you hear.
Change your password. Don't click on suspicious links.
Right. But honestly, that's not enough anymore.
So what are the threats we need to be worried about in 2025?
Well, first up, phishing.
Phishing? I thought I was pretty good at spotting those fake emails.
It's gotten a lot more sophisticated than those Nigerian print scams.
Oh, I remember those.
Now we're talking spear phishing.
Spear phishing.
Yeah, where they use your personal information.
To make the message super convincing.
Right. They might even impersonate someone you know.
Like a friend or a company I do business with.
Exactly. And it's not just email anymore.
Oh, no.
Text messages, social media, even those fake delivery notifications.
The ones that say your package is delayed?
Yep. Those can look incredibly real.
So even if I'm usually cautious,
you could still fall for it.
If they hit the right emotional buttons.
It preys on our natural instincts.
Yeah. Our desire to help or fix a problem quickly.
Exactly. It's all about manipulation.
Okay, so phishing is one thing.
Just the tip of the iceberg.
But then there's malware and ransomware.
Now, that stuff can be really scary.
Like something out of a movie?
Imagine losing all your photos.
Financial documents, everything.
And it's not just about losing files anymore.
What do you mean?
Ransomware is on the rise.
Where they hold your data hostage.
Until you pay up. And they're not just targeting businesses.
So individuals are getting hit too.
More and more these days.
So it's not just about losing some files. It's about potentially having to pay a hefty ransom just to get your own life back.
That's their goal, to hold your data hostage.
This is where it gets really interesting. The research mentions credential stuffing attacks, which I've never heard of before.
It's a tactic that exploits our bad habit of reusing passwords across multiple accounts.
Oh no, I'm guilty of that.
Hackers get their hands on leaked passwords from one data breach.
Which happens all the time.
Right. And then they try those passwords on other platforms.
So if I use the same password for my bank and my online shopping account?
They hit the jackpot.
Okay. So strong, unique passwords are clearly crucial.
Mm-hmm.
I know we all hear that advice. But now I'm really starting to understand why it matters so much.
It's the foundation of good cybersecurity. It's like locking your front door.
But there's more to it than just passwords.
Oh, yeah. We're just getting started.
Right.
Yeah.
Our sources also talk about Wi-Fi security, which I think a lot of people overlook. We assume if it has a password, it's fine.
That's a common misconception.
So it's not just about having a password.
We need to talk about encryption protocols.
Encryption protocols.
Specifically WPA2 versus WPA3.
So this is getting a bit technical.
Think of it this way. WPA2 is like a sturdy wooden door.
Decent protection.
But WPA3 is like a steel door with multiple locks.
Much tougher to crack.
And it's not just about encryption. It's about those default router passwords.
The ones that come preset.
Hackers often use lists of those to exploit routers.
Wait, so even if I set a password on my Wi-Fi?
It might not be enough if it's a common one.
I had no idea. It's surprisingly easy to find those lists online.
Hackers know people don't bother changing them.
Okay, so we're already seeing how multi-layered this whole cybersecurity thing is. It's not just one thing you do. It's a whole mindset shift.
Absolutely. And there's one more piece of the puzzle.
Let's hear it.
Social engineering.
The source mentioned that.
It's where the human element comes in.
But I wasn't quite clear on how it works. It sounds kind of sneaky.
It is. Imagine getting a call from someone claiming to be from your bank.
Okay.
They sound official. Use your name, maybe even know your last few transactions.
They've done their research.
They say there's suspicious activity.
Uh-oh.
And urgently need you to confirm your account number and password.
to verify my identity.
Exactly. What would you do?
Honestly, in a panic, I might just blurt it out.
That's what they're counting on.
Our fear, our willingness to cooperate.
Social engineering is all about manipulation.
Getting people to give up sensitive information.
And it's not just phone calls. Text messages, social media, even someone approaching you in person.
So it's not just about technology. It's about understanding how people can be tricked. That's a bit unsettling.
Yeah.
But knowing how these attacks work is the first step to defending ourselves right.
Exactly.
So let's start equipping ourselves with the tools to fight back.
Sounds good to me. I'm ready to get tactical.
Me too. Let's arm ourselves with some serious cybersecurity knowledge.
Let's do it.
All right, so we've explored the battlefield. Let's talk about our arsenal. What are the best weapons we can use to defend ourselves against these cyber threats?
The absolute cornerstone of any good defense, and I can't emphasize this enough, is strong, unique passwords.
For every single account?
Every single one.
That's easy to say, but in reality, who can possibly remember dozens of complex passwords?
The challenge, for sure.
Without writing them down.
Which is a huge no-no.
Exactly. So what's the solution?
Password managers.
Password managers.
They're like a digital vault for all your passwords.
So I only need to remember one password.
One master password to unlock the vault.
And it handles the rest.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It generates and remembers all those super strong, unique passwords.
Okay, that sounds amazing.
Yeah.
But are they really secure?
That's a valid question.
What if someone gets my master password?
Then they have access to everything, right?
That's what I'm worried about.
That's why it's so important to choose a reputable password manager.
One that's known for its security.
Exactly. One that uses strong encryption.
And offers additional security features.
Like two-factor authentication for your master password.
So it's like a vault with multiple layers of security.
You got it.
Okay, so password managers are high on our list of defenses. What else can we do to fortify our digital fortresses?
Two-factor authentication or 2FA.
I've heard of that.
It adds an extra layer of protection.
By requiring more than just my password.
Right. Usually a unique code.
Sent to my phone.
Or generated by an app.
So even if someone steals my password.
They still can't get in.
Without that second factor.
Exactly. Like having a double lock on your door.
I like that analogy.
And there are different types of 2FA.
Oh.
SMS text message codes are the most basic.
Right.
But app-based authentication, like Google Authenticator or Authy.
Those are more secure.
They offer stronger security. And then there are FIDO2 security keys.
FIDO2 keys.
Those are small physical devices.
You plug into your computer or phone.
Right.
I've heard of those.
Yeah.
But what makes them so special?
What makes FIDO2 so powerful?
Yeah.
Is that it's phishing resistant.
Phishing resistant.
Unlike SMS or app-based codes.
Which can be intercepted.
Exactly. FIDO2 keys use cryptography.
To verify my identity.
Directly with the website or service.
Without any codes that can be stolen.
Right. It's like having a unique digital fingerprint.
It can't be faked.
Exactly.
Wow, that's impressive.
It's the gold standard of 2FA.
Definitely something to consider.
Especially for your most sensitive accounts.
Okay. Password manager, 2FA check.
Yeah.
What about software updates?
Oh, software updates.
Are they really as crucial as everyone says?
Absolutely. Think of them as patching holes in your armor.
Okay.
Hackers are constantly looking for vulnerabilities.
In software.
Right. And updates often include fixes for those security flaws.
So ignoring updates is like leaving my front door unlocked.
Pretty much.
Okay, I'm getting the picture. It's not just about getting the latest features.
It's about staying protected.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Now, on to Wi-Fi security. We talked about encryption earlier.
Right. WPA3 is the way to go.
But what are some specific steps we can take to lock down our networks?
Besides using WPA3 encryption, change the default username and password for your router.
The one it comes with.
Yep. Hackers love those.
Because they're easy to guess.
They use lists of common default credentials.
So make sure yours is unique and strong.
And disable features like remote management.
NWPS.
Wi-Fi protected setup.
What's wrong with that?
It can have security flaws.
I had no idea. I'm realizing how many little things we overlook.
It's all about being proactive.
Closing those potential entry points.
Exactly. Now let's talk about those pesky phishing scams.
Yes. Any advice for avoiding those cleverly disguised traps?
Be extra cautious with links and attachments.
In emails and texts.
Especially if they seem unexpected or too good to be true.
So like winning the lottery.
Exactly. Always verify the sender's identity.
How do I do that?
Hover over the email address.
To see if it's legitimate.
And check for subtle misspellings.
Before clicking or downloading anything.
Right.
That's a good reminder. It's so easy to click on something without thinking.
Especially when we're busy or distracted.
Any other red flags?
Pay attention to the language.
What do you mean?
Phishing emails often create a sense of urgency.
Like I have to act now.
Or they might threaten to close your account.
Or offer a limited time deal.
To get you to click.
So it's all about pausing and thinking critically.
Before reacting.
Makes sense. Mm. What about antivirus software and firewalls?
Those are still essential.
Even in 2025.
Absolutely. An antivirus program helps detect and remove malware.
That might have snuck past my other defenses.
Think of it as a security guard patrolling your system.
Looking for troublemakers.
Exactly. And a firewall acts like a barrier.
Between my computer and the internet.
Blocking unauthorized access.
So it's like a security guard at the gate.
Checking everyone who's trying to enter.
Most computers come with a built-in firewall, right?
They do. But for added protection.
What do you suggest?
Consider an external firewall.
Especially if I'm working with sensitive data.
Or have a home network with multiple devices.
Okay, so we've got our antivirus and firewall in place.
Uh-huh.
What about data backups?
Data backups are your insurance policy.
Against what?
Ransomware or any other event that could cause data loss.
Oh, so like a hard drive failure.
Exactly. It's your safety net.
If my files are held hostage,
you can restore them from a backup.
Without paying the ransom.
Exactly.
So it's not just about preventing attacks.
It's about having a plan B.
What's the best approach to data backups?
The 3-2-1 backup strategy is a good guideline.
3-2-1.
Three copies of your data.
Okay. On two different media types.
Like a hard drive and a cloud service.
Right. And with one copy stored off-site.
So even if one backup fails.
You have multiple redundancies.
That's a smart approach. Now, we've talked a lot about technical safeguards.
The nuts and bolts of cybersecurity.
But what about social media?
Ah, yes. The wild west of the internet.
We all spend so much time online.
How can we stay safe in that constantly evolving landscape?
That's the question.
It's all about being mindful of what you share.
And who can see it.
Exactly. Review your privacy settings.
On social media platforms.
Limit the personal information you post publicly.
And be wary of friend requests from strangers.
Good advice.
Mm-hmm.
I think we often forget how much we reveal online without even realizing it.
What are some specific things we should avoid sharing?
Details like your home address.
So number.
Birthday travel plans.
That can be used for social engineering attacks.
Or identity theft.
Right. It's all about finding that balance.
Between staying connected and protecting your privacy.
And speaking of people.
Yes. What about our families?
Especially children.
They're growing up in this digital world.
It's crucial to educate them about online safety.
Start with age-appropriate conversations.
About online scams, safe browsing habits, strong passwords.
So not scaring them, but empowering them.
Exactly. And parental controls can be helpful.
For younger children.
To filter content, manage screen time, monitor activity.
But it's also important to talk to them.
Build trust.
So they feel comfortable coming to us if they have questions.
Absolutely. It's about finding that balance between protection and guidance.
And finally, what about VPNs?
VPNs.
Virtual private networks.
We hear a lot about those.
Are they really necessary for everyday home users?
A VPN encrypts your internet traffic.
Adding an extra layer of privacy.
Especially on public Wi-Fi.
So they're good for public Wi-Fi.
And for added privacy at home.
But maybe not essential for everyday browsing.
They can slow down your internet speed.
So there's a trade-off.
But if privacy is a top concern,
a VPN is worth considering. We've covered a lot of ground here.
A lot of ground.
But there's one more crucial topic.
Let's hear it.
What happens if, despite all our best efforts,
we get hacked?
Exactly.
Yeah.
What should we do?
That's a great question. Because even with all the precautions,
breaches can still happen.
So it's essential to have a plan.
Okay, let's break it down. What are the first things we should do?
If you suspect you've been compromised,
yeah.
Change your passwords immediately.
For all my accounts.
Especially sensitive ones.
Banking, email, social media.
Exactly. Then check your account activity.
For any unauthorized logins or transactions.
Right. It's all about damage control.
Contain the breach and secure my accounts.
What else? What else should I do?
Enable two-factor authentication everywhere.
To make it harder to regain access.
And run a full security scan with an updated antivirus program.
To check for malware.
Good thinking.
So changing passwords, checking accounts, enabling 2FA scanning for malware. What if I suspect identity theft?
Contact credit bureaus to freeze your credit. That'll prevent anyone from opening new accounts in my name.
Exactly.
And finally, should I report the incident to anyone?
Yes. Notify your bank email provider, any affected service provider.
So they could take action.
You might also want to consider reporting it to law enforcement.
Depending on the severity.
Right.
Okay, so we have a clear action plan. change passwords, check accounts, enable 2FA scan for malware freeze credit if needed, and report the incident. This is invaluable information because it helps us feel empowered, even in a worst-case scenario. But before we wrap up, I want to come back to something you said earlier about cybersecurity being an ongoing process.
You're absolutely right. It's not a one-time fix.
It's a continuous journey.
Of staying informed, adapting to new threats.
And implementing the best possible defenses. And that can feel overwhelming at times, especially with our busy lives. How can we make cybersecurity more manageable without feeling like we need to become experts overnight?
You don't have to become an expert overnight.
That's a relief.
It's more about building good habits.
Small steps.
Exactly. Start with the fundamentals like strong passwords and software updates.
The basics we always hear about.
Right. Then you can gradually add more layers of protection.
Like 2FA and password managers.
And VPNs.
As I become more comfortable.
It's about finding that balance.
Between security and convenience.
We don't want to make our digital lives too complicated.
Right. We still want to enjoy being online.
Exactly. It's all about finding that sweet spot.
And that's what I appreciate about this deep dive.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about fear-mongering.
Oh, no.
It's about giving us the tools.
To make informed decisions.
And practical steps we can take.
To feel more secure.
Knowledge is power, right?
Absolutely. The more we understand the threats.
In the tools available.
The better prepared we are.
To make those smart choices.
So true.
We've covered a lot of ground today.
From phishing to ransomware.
We've explored a whole arsenal of defenses.
From strong passwords to data backups.
But we've also emphasized the human element.
It's our choices that really matter.
Our behaviors online.
That determines how secure we are.
It's not just about the technology.
It's about awareness and education.
Making those smart choices.
Exactly. Which brings us to a final thought-provoking question for our listeners.
Oh, I like this.
What's one specific action you will take today based on what you've learned?
It could be something small.
Like setting up a password manager.
Or enabling 2FA.
Or even just talking to your family about online safety.
The key is to take action.
Any action.
Even a small step can make a difference.
Absolutely. It all adds up.
So I challenge our listeners.
To take that first step. Make it a priority.
We don't have to do everything at once.
Just start small and build from there.
Cybersecurity is a journey.
Not a destination.
Every step we take makes us a less appealing target.
That's the goal.
I love that perspective.
Yeah.
It's not about achieving perfect security.
It's about making yourself a harder target.
Reducing your risk.
Exactly. And remember, cybersecurity is ongoing.
It never ends.
We have to stay informed and adapt to new threats.
Always be learning.
Continuously improving our defenses.
Well said. The more we learn and share this knowledge,
the stronger we become.
It's a team effort.
We all have a role to play
in making the digital world a safer place.
Absolutely. Well said.
So thank you for joining us on this cybersecurity adventure.
It's been a pleasure.
We hope you found it informative and empowering.
And maybe even a little bit fun.
We'll be back soon with another deep dive into a fascinating topic.
Until then, stay curious, stay vigilant, and stay safe out there.
That's it for this episode of The Deep Dive. Keep exploring, keep learning, and keep those digital defenses strong.